Good evening. Tonight's episode of QI is even more ridiculous than usual, partly because ridiculous is our theme and partly because we're filming in March 2020 without an audience because of the coronavirus outbreak. So bear with us as we bring you a show replete with ridiculous riddles. This episode of QI with the absurd Holly Walsh, the preposterous Maisie Adam, and the ludicrous David Mitchell, and no, but seriously, Alan Davis. And their buzzers are a right laugh. Holly goes. Maisie goes. David goes. And Alan goes. Extra point, who is that?
Jimmy Carr.
Is that a fox on heat?
No point in saying anything amusing, there's no one to hear it.
Okay.
Jimmy Carr, that's
it's
a factual answer.
Get an extra point.
Thank you.
What is the funny thing about not having an audience?
That exact noise.
That noise, that silence.
That silence.
I mean, it's a sort of interesting experiment.
I mean, I've definitely done shows in the Edinburgh Fringe where this would count as quite a good audience.
Yes.
There's nearly 10 of them and, you know, only some of them are part of the team.
So. I did the smallest audience I've ever paid to. I did a gig once in which my mother-in-law turned up.
Oh, God.
Just your mother-in-law?
Just my mother-in-law.
No.
Yeah. Are you sure that wasn't an intervention?
No, I'm not sure at all.
Sandy's still calling it a gig.
Yeah. What's the smallest gig you've ever played?
Oh, it was probably a preview just before Edinburgh, and my flatmate from uni, Hazel, turned up. And it was just her, and then these two guys had come to Exit Flyer, my show, but obviously my audience was just Hazel.
Yeah.
And, well, Hazel went home with about 40 flyers for a show.
Yeah.
And both
yeah.
the guys.
Yeah. Yeah. Yeah, and both guys. It was a great night for Hazel.
Yeah.
This does have the feel of, like, you know, when you used to put a play on for your mum and dad in the front room?
Yeah.
It does sort of feel a bit like that.
Only, so really, you have David Mitchell yeah. and Danny Topfig and Alan Davis in it.
Yeah.
So there is canned laughter, but not for us. We never use it on QI. But laugh tracks for TV shows were first created in 1950. And there was an American sound engineer called Charlie Douglas, and he invented what is called a laugh box, L-A-F-F. And it was just loads of different laughs that you could use if you weren't recording in front of a live audience. We're still not going to use them.
And that was just to blow my own trumpet, because it was only one of a team of contributors. But I had a radio show in the late 90s, and we were so funny that the people at BBC Comedy said we can use those laughs on nearly every other programme we make.
And sell them on. Sell them on.
Fill them in.
Feeding off that laughter bank.
That was the best compliment I ever had in my whole career.
We've kept your laughs and we're using them on other shows.
There's real joy in those laughs. Yeah. That'll save a load of programmes.
I think most of them were for Kevin Eldon.
It's like,
God. But this guy, Charlie Douglas, he monopolised the Hollywood laugh track market, and apparently there was a limited number of laughs and you could recognise them. They came up repeatedly, the same laughs, over and over again. Some people don't like it, but the research suggests it works in principle. The UCL's Institute of Cognitive Neuroscience, they exposed people to a list of deliberately weak dad jokes. So they ran the jokes with no laugh at all. They ran them with a recording of being told to laugh at nothing in particular, so a fake laugh, and then with another recording of people who were genuinely laughing, so a real laugh, and the ones with the real laughs rated higher than the fake ones, and even the fake ones rated higher than the no laugh. So we're going to have an experiment now. So I'm going to tell you the actual joke that the researchers used, and we'll try it with and without a laugh track.
Okay.
Okay. So, what do you call a sleeping dinosaur?
I don't know.
A dino snore. Wow. OK.
I think it might have been the delivery, actually.
Do you think it was my fault?
Yeah.
OK,
we should have got a professional comedian to
I should have. If only I could have found somebody who can tell a joke.
Also, it's not fair. It's not fair to do in front of comedians because, I don't know about you, but I'm just so hardened to watching comedians say jokes. So someone could do the best joke in the world and I'm like, yeah, that's good.
Yeah,
that's
yeah.
A
so
really good
no,
joke.
I've lost all sense of joy in comedy.
Yes.
So have most of my fans.
Yes.
But that would be a great way of testing comic yeah. delivery because there's virtually no humour in the joke.
No.
Yet it is a joke.
Yes.
People know where they're supposed to laugh.
Yeah.
You've got a terrible joke, though.
I do have a... this is a joke I tell sometimes
okay.
for radio recordings. I didn't even think of it, and the amount of thought that goes into it is so small that
yeah.
It is not mine. The joke is, what's a ghost's favourite country?
What is a ghost's favourite country?
France. did better than Dino Snore,
did way
it?
Better than Dino
yeah,
Snore.
Yeah, but I think that was a pity laugh.
Yeah.
No,
okay.
Take what you can get.
I think I was more laughing at David's pure commitment to the punchline.
I think that's it.
It's the way he tells
it. He sort of delivered yours like, I know this is bad, but it's for the experiment. Yours was, this can work. I'm willing it to work.
Okay, let's try my joke with a laugh track.
Okay.
See if that goes better. What do you call a sleeping dinosaur?
I don't know.
A dino snore.
Oh, yeah.
I feel like we're an American sitcom.
Yeah. Okay.
David, let's try your joke with a laugh track. OK, go ahead.
What's a ghost's favourite country?
I don't know.
People just love the whole vibe of it. it's like the best of Ronnie Corbett. You get laughs on the way to
this
the
is what I'm talking about. Women are not as funny as men.
We did have a complaint last year from a viewer about canned laughter, which we do not use, as you can hear, and there wasn't any, and we investigated the confusion about why this woman was so upset, and it turned out she didn't like the sound of Jimmy Carr's laugh.
Really?
I know.
It was his girlfriend.
In Argentina, they have teams of professional laughers, arredores, who are employed to go to television recordings and laugh.
That's quite common, though, isn't it? That's an old tradition.
What?
Theatrical tradition. They used to call it a claque. Which is a French word. So if you opened a play or an opera or something, there'd be people scattered around who would encourage
really?
To know when to laugh or when to cry or, you know.
Cry?
Yeah, because
it's like
if you don't understand the opera, you don't know when it's getting sad. So if people are around you going, oh, things like that, I'd be good at it. I'd do that on ferries. Oh, no. We're too close.
apparently,
to the tanker, we're too close.
It's so vital because otherwise ferry journeys can be boring.
Yes,
really boring. Last time I was on a ferry, I was 45 minutes queuing with a tray for the worst meal of my life. And if someone had been causing a panic because we were too near a tanker,
would
have gone much more quickly.
Such a long wait and yet so disgusting.
People who'd eaten could be going, don't bother.
Was it
look out the window?
And then
the Isle of Wight is 10 minutes away. Just wait.
Are you okay?
I'm now thinking back to every show I've seen, though, where people have cried in it and wondered if they were...
Where they moved.
Yeah, you know those, like, Edinburgh shows where they're funny, but about 40 minutes in, there's a really hard-hitting moment. And people... I went to go and see one and everyone around me was crying. And now I think, were they a plant? Were they the equivalent of canned laughter?
No, because you don't need it because people are very suggestible. And let's be honest, there isn't canned laughter used in British television and it sometimes gets accused of it and it's very, very annoying to those of us who feel that we've elicited a genuine laugh. But the truth is we've elicited a genuine laugh from people who've come along excited, it was free and they want to be helpful.
Yeah.
So they know they're supposed to laugh.
It's a British manners.
People are nice. True. So they
if
sort
the
of
audience
go, well,
are very rarely ill-tempered.
Yeah. Exactly. That was clearly meant to amuse me. I'm not going to sit around working out whether it actually did. I'm going to make the required noise. And that's what they reliably do. And God bless them.
There is an interesting thing, though. There's a guy who's the world's leading expert on laughter, which is a sort of interesting job, a guy called Robert Provine. And he found that we are 30 times more likely to laugh when we're in company than we are on our own.
Oh, that's definitely true. I can watch, like, films or TV shows that I find genuinely hilarious, but if I'm on my own, like, nothing will come out.
Also, that inverse is true because you are probably 30 times more likely to cry on your own than you are in company.
Yes. That is true.
I made myself laugh so hard the other day.
Did you help?
Yeah, because I did a fart and it sounded like somebody was calling out my name as though they were dying. Like, Holly. Like that. It was the funniest fart I've ever done in my life.
I once did a poo that made me cry.
Maisie, I'm
really
so sorry.
Cry for ages.
Maisie's new to the show.
Feel free to join in, Maisie. Yeah. Have you ever pooed and cried at the same time? Who hasn't?
I feel like when I know, I'll know.
Yeah.
I look forward to it.
It's like love.
I'll text you all when it happens.
You might cry out as well. Help me!
I'll just hear canned laughter over it as well.
I think farts are funny, but I don't find my own funny. And I don't know if that's a failure as a comedian.
No, it's just a failure of timing. Failure of timing.
Sorry?
It's a failure of timing. Very good.
Extra point to David.
Failure of timing.
Yeah.
I don't find my farts funny because I don't fart.
What? That's not true.
There's almost a continual release of gas. It's not what you would call a fart.
It's a weird... I'm going to...
It's an emission, a constant emission.
I don't fart, and I think it's a worry.
I think that is a worry.
Yes. I don't let gas out.
Are you able to dive to the bottom of a swimming pool or are you just constantly floating?
No, I think what's going to happen is that one day something will ping like that and I'll just float round backwards out.
Yeah. Well, one day you're going to fart. Oh, my God. I hope it's not in isolation.
Do you know what? If you're going to go, what a way to go.
I know. Just go flying backwards around the room. Laughter...
You return to Denmark like a salmon. Where does she land? Denmark, of course.
I think anyway, salmon would go to Norway. That doesn't matter. A sleeping dinosaur is a dino snore, and anyone who finds that funny must be having a laugh. Oh, I like the applause. The applause is good. That was nice. Here's a riddle-iculous question. Why is a raven like a writing desk?
That's a quote, isn't it?
It is from what?
I think it sounds sort of Lewis Carroll or something.
It is Lewis Carroll-y. So where are we going? Lewis Carroll?
Narnia.
Alice's Adventures in Wonderland.
Who did Narnia?
C.S. Lewis.
Yeah, I always get them two mixed up as well. Yeah.
And Lewis Collins, I get mixed up. Lewis. Alice in Wonderland, Narnia, and the Professional.
And the Professional. Are those your three cultural go-to?
Well, I think if I was to self-isolate for 3 months...
Say.
That wouldn't be a bad start.
So it's a question that the Mad Hatter poses in Alice's Adventures in Wonderland. Why is a raven like a writing desk? And it wasn't originally meant to have an answer. And then in a later edition, Carol included this note. I may as well put on record here what seems to me to be a fairly appropriate answer, because it can produce a few notes, though they are very flat, and it is never put with the wrong end front. So what happened was it was supposed to be an internal joke, because look at the way he spelt never. He spelt it like that, which is backwards is...
Raven. Yes.
Raven. But the publishers incorrectly corrected the spelling, so the joke was completely missed. And, in fact, nobody noticed the error until 1976. But it's a meta-riddle. It doesn't mean anything.
I mean, is that really a riddle? It's just a stupid thing
You just
to
find
say.
It annoying.
Yeah, it's just, like, too smart.
There was a very popular one in the 1890s, when is a mouse if it spins? To which the answer was, because the higher it gets, the fewer. I mean, they're just ridiculous. They don't really particularly...
This is the sort of humour that develops in non-studio audience conditions.
Yes.
One time, Lewis Collins and Martin Shaw were on a stakeout in a hotel room, and you could hear the Professionals theme being played very, very slowly on a heavy brass instrument, I think possibly a tuba. So it was going... And then Martin Shaw went to the window to look out at that. And if there'd been a man there with a tuba, it would have been the funniest thing that had ever happened on ITV. And I know that's not a high bar. But as it was, they didn't even cut to the outside. So we never knew if there was someone with a tuba. And judging by his reaction, I'd say there wasn't.
That would have been a great joke.
Would have been a great joke. Especially if Lewis Collins had said, I hate the tuba.
or something.
And then had a cigarette.
Tonally, would it have been right for the Professional?
Oh,
that's
no.
the question.
No, no.
It'd be great.
Earlier on, he'd been in a Capri and on a date with a young woman and they'd got a call to say there's urgent terrorism and he just dropped her off at a bus stop. He didn't even run her home.
When it's your next big birthday, I think we should all club together and film you playing a tuba and cut it in.
Yeah.
And then whenever it goes out on gold or whatever, everyone will be like, what?
It could totally supersede the original cut of that episode.
Yeah. Right?
Like with Blade Runner, it's impossible to get the non-director's cut. Yeah. The version without Alan Davis playing a tuba 40
yeah.
years later.
It's no longer about, yeah.
It'll make people furious. Yeah. And in fact, they'll want to see, where's the guy with the tuba? He should crop up in every yeah. episode. And there will be an opportunity.
It's like, where's Wally? Yeah. But in yeah. 70s TV shows, there's always an interstitial with.
I don't think you need a tuba, you can just make that funny noise. Yeah. most famous riddle of all must be the riddle of the Sphinx, which is in Oedipus Rex. Does anybody know what the riddle is?
No, I can't remember. It's something about as well,
what walks on four legs in the morning, is
yeah.
that right?
What has four legs in the morning, two legs at noon and three legs in the evening, to which Richard Osman has suggested a poorly organised darts match. But you needed to get it right, because the Sphinx would strangle and eat anybody who couldn't answer it correctly. So there's some pressure,
yes.
I think.
What if you were like, I don't care?
It'd just eat you.
Fine. Yeah.
What is it, then?
Man who crawls on all fours as a baby, then walks on 2 feet as an adult, and then uses a walking stick in old age.
Yep.
There's always, like, more than one answer, though, to every riddle, isn't there? Like, yeah. the one that goes, I'm tall when young and I'm short when I'm old, what am I?
Yeah. What?
Well, it's a candle. But it could also be, like, my Auntie Sue.
You're right. Like, and also, what happens is you get the answer and you think, I can't exactly. believe I paid attention for that long because I don't care.
It gets really in your head and then the payoff is so very little.
You really need the extra not being eaten by the Sphinx.
Yeah.
The pressure worth bothering.
Yeah, you need the stakes. Yeah.
Yes, yes.
Yeah. Yeah. You need to be pressured into thinking, I'm going to shit myself if I don't get this right.
Yes.
Or like...
So you'd be fine because you don't pass wind.
No, no, nothing at
all. You'd be fine. You could just go...
Well, I mean, that's a riddle in itself, isn't it?
And just tuba your way off.
Never not funny. Sandy?
And now for a really risible question. Who was doing the best stand-up 500 years ago?
Was it you?
Well, Ken Dodd must be on your klaxon, surely.
Sat next to Ken Dodd at the most glorious dinner one time. We were together for about 4 hours. He didn't stop. He'd just done a show and he just carried on.
Yeah.
It was astonishing.
We saw him like 2 months before he died or something. And it was about 3 hours after the time it was meant to. It was about 1 a.m. Mm.
People Wimbledon Theatre. Coach loads of pensioners with a driver saying, I've got to drive you back to the hotel. But we haven't seen the Diddy Men.
It was one of the best evenings of my life.
Was it endearing or was it quite irritating?
Well, I had Julian Fellowes on the other side, so it was terribly endearing.
What is this dinner?
Honestly.
It's a dream.
Yeah.
It was the Illuminati.
I was on the other side of the table with Martin Shaw and Lewis Collins.
The best stand-up 500 years ago.
1500.
So we are talking 16th century.
Martin Luther.
Well, German priests.
German priests?
So, we're in the right...
Like Henry VIII's time, is it?
Yeah, Henry VIII's time,
Because Germany went a bit crazy in the early 16th. Well, I'm not the craziest it's ever gone.
No. But, I mean, they've got form.
Yeah, but relatively, because there were huge, horrible wars and fighting between the various Protestant and Catholic bits, weren't there?
There were. But this is a proper thing called Rhesus Paschalis, so the Easter laugh. And the idea was to put jokes into the Easter sermons. It supposedly reflected a perception that the resurrection was a practical joke played on the devil.
He's not going down well.
So, look at him. He's fantastic, isn't he?
We've all had an audience like that. He's going, stop!
So, the sort of shtick that they would do from the pulpit, there was a preacher who ate pancakes while doing cuckoo impressions.
Oh, brilliant.
There was one who lay in cow dung and pretended to give birth to a calf while hissing like a goose.
Oh, that's a bit try-hard, isn't
it? I know, really. Yeah. And one church where the priest got a layman to dress in a hood and convinced him he was a priest, which I think that's not as good. Yeah. But there were loads of lewd jokes about nuns, there was general bad language, and lots of serious-minded churchmen at the time, people like Erasmus, they thought it was a dreadful thing. Erasmus denounced the sermons so full of obscenities that a decent man could not tell them at a dinner party without shame. So this practice of Rhesus Paschalis was
banned.
Where
did Jesus stand on obscenities? Is there a view expressed in the Gospels about obscenities?
Well, he must be a bit annoyed his name is used
as an obscenity.
Yeah.
Yeah,
I mean, that if everyone was like, Alan Davis off.
Yeah.
Alan Davis.
But no one says Jesus off.
Jesus off.
It counts as taking the Lord's name in vain.
Yeah.
Jesus.
People go, oh, Jesus Christ. Off. If someone went, oh, Davis. I wouldn't go, well, I'd never
Jesus
be so
Jesus off. We need to start that being a thing.
Yeah.
Just Jesus. Oh, just, Jesus. Is that off. What you tell someone to go away but come back 3 days later?
Yeah.
Was he easily offended?
Who, Jesus?
No,
Jesus.
He was pretty...
He was pretty cool.
Because
he made
the Anglican
that...
Church is so easily offended.
I don't think they are.
No?
Well, my mum's a vicar. I don't think they are.
She's not easily offended.
No.
Is your mum a vicar?
Yeah, my mum's a vicar, yeah.
The elves have just given me a quote from Matthew 5:34, but I tell you not to swear at all. There are lots
no
of...
No F-words in the Bible, are there? No F-words or C-words.
Is your mother an Anglican priest?
Yeah, C of E. Is that... That's Anglican, isn't
yeah.
it?
Yeah.
Wow, you've really paid attention while you were growing up. That's...
I get muddled up between all the different denominations and sort of...
But it's good to know what... Which one your mother is, I just
Well,
say.
She's Church of England, so I suppose, yes, that's Anglican. In answer to your question, yes, yes. My mother is Anglican.
I suppose in a way it is, yes.
yes. OK, there are lots of excellent, hilarious Anglican priests who were in the Church of England. I'm trying to help you here. There was a guy called the Reverend Robert Hawker. He was a Cornish Anglican priest. He particularly... I mean, look at him.
You can and tell by the pasty on his head.
Isn't he great? He liked to moonlight as a mermaid. So for several months, he dressed in a seaweed wig and he sat every evening on a rock in Bude Harbour singing mermaid songs.
Yeah, but he's obviously... he's obviously start raving mad and well, needed help.
No, I'd be in church every week if that was my...
Would you, but, though?
Yeah.
That's not where he's doing it, in church. In church, he's doing the normal stuff, you know.
He was not doing the normal stuff in church. So he first of all, he did this mermaid singing. He was naked apart from a cloth.
Oh, no,
a waterproof cloth wrapped around him for his tail.
I'm out. You're like Dragon's Den. I'm out.
And then apparently there was a local farmer who was so irritated by the singing that he threatened him with a shotgun. So he concluded his time as a mermaid by doing one rousing rendition of God Save the King and then swam home. But in the church, his 10 cats made up most of the congregation at his church services, and he saw one of them catching a mouse on a Sunday, so he excommunicated the cat. He's... Marvellous.
Oh, my God.
And then I like this one very much. Reverend Edward Drax Free, he was the rector at Sutton in Bedfordshire. He impregnated a succession of housemaids. I mean, he was very busy. He was perpetually drunk.
Good God. He did?
Yeah. He stole the lead off his own church roof.
Has he got the biggest head in Christendom, or have they got tiny, tiny heads?
It's not pleasant, is it? He was fantastic. He kept the church locked because he didn't want anybody to try and attend a service. Anyway, in 1830, a party was set by the local bishop to remove him, and they found he'd barricaded himself into the rectory together with his favourite serving girl and two pistols, and they tried to lay siege on him. He held up for 2 weeks until his claret ran out.
Oh, my God.
Surprised the claret lasted 2 weeks for the look of it.
Yes.
Yeah.
Anyway, sad story. He died penniless.
No shit.
It was all going
couldn't
so well.
Couldn't get a job
well.
After that.
He died in 1843. It's a sort of lovely detail from history. He was run over by a varnish maker's cart.
Of course he was going to go in a weird way, wasn't
yeah,
he? He was
yeah.
not going to go
no.
quiet.
What's improved by extra rhubarb?
Extra custard?
Using rhubarb in a different sense.
Well, rhubarb as in the noise people make
waffle.
It sound like a crowd is talking?
You get an extra point. That is exactly rhubarb, right. Rhubarb. It's actors' jargon for the chat that extras do in the background. Does anybody know why the rhubarb thing started?
Rhubarb.
A good sort of noise that sounds like talking.
I think so. I mean...
More talking-y word than other words.
Sorry, so is it... Do they do it so that... It sounds for a sound thing, or is it that
mouth is moving?
When they were doing Japanese prisoner of war films after the war, they were all shot in the UK. They got anyone in who looked remotely Asian because they just needed to fill the background with extras who might be in a Japanese prisoner of war camp. And obviously, these people were from many different countries and nobody spoke Japanese, so they just got them to say, I tie your shoe, you tie my shoe.
So I knew a comedian from Dublin and he taught me how to do a Northern Irish accent and you just say, bore, defore, de-war.
Bore, defore,
de-war. Bore, defore, de-war, bore, defore, de-war.
A good way to say Spice Girls in Glaswegian...
Oh, it's so good, isn't it?
..is to say Space Ghetto.
In an American accent.
In an American accent.
Right, Space Ghetto.
Space Ghetto.
Space Ghetto. Oh,
yeah. Good, isn't it?
Oh, yeah, that is good.
Blows your mind.
Yeah. Blows your mind. Extras are not highly paid individuals, but if you have a large crowd, that's obviously extremely expensive. So lots of films use something else now. What do you think they use instead of hiring extras for? If you've got a massive crowd scene.
computer graphic people.
No, it's inflatable dolls.
Oh, no. No.
Yeah.
Like what you get on a hen party.
No, there they are. Look, this is the film Seabiscuit. You know the one about the horse race.
I'm not a sex doll. I'm an extra.
So, genuinely, that's easier. Blowing up a load of sex dolls is easier than computers.
You can get a crowd of 10,000 in a truck and they can be reused.
I mean, I'm sure they've got pumps.
Yeah, I don't think it's somebody going...
But still...
Mind you, if you were an extra and you could send an inflatable version of yourself, you'd be foolish not to.
I think I've been on panel shows where I might as well have.
Sorry, we're supposed to just go, no, no.
Not this one.
There are lots of films that it's been used in. I think The King's Speech was another one.
I thought they always CGI'd them nowadays.
No. Very expensive.
I thought it was sort of just like copy and paste.
I thought they used crowds from Alan Davis's show in the 90s. They just used them as cutaways for Gladiator.
If it was my film, they'd just copy and paste Hazel over and over in the background.
So, from the height of ridiculousness to the ridiculousness of height, how will short people save the world?
Is it by going on a baking show and becoming a national treasure?
Oh, extra point.
There we go. We got it.
Eating less?
Yes, it is sort of...
Breathing less?
It is. Yes, it's to do with all of those.
Breathing less, did you say?
Well, it's got to be better, basically, overall, because broadly speaking, a short person functions like a medium-height person or a tall person and takes less fuel and uses up less space.
That is exactly right.
They'll be the heroes of the moment with the stockpiling. Yeah, they're not going for the top shelves. No. They can't get there.
No, exactly.
If we all die out, it's my lot's fault.
Yeah. Are you very tall?
Yeah.
So there's a theory called reventropy, which is that humans ought to be shorter. There's a guy called Thomas Samaras. In 1994, he wrote a book called The Truth About Your Height, and he argued that people were getting taller because they had excessive protein in their diet, and this was leading to much greater consumption of everything. So you needed more land for farming, you get more waste, you get more pollution, and in order to preserve resources, really, you need to control the size of human beings, and that being shorter is good for you because it's... Look at that, that's me and Richard Osman. Being short is good for you, it slows ageing. Shorter people do have longer lifespans.
Really?
Yeah.
So you hit your head a lot less, though, probably.
That's true. I've never hit my head on a doorway, not once.
But you've probably caught the corner of a table a few times.
and the lid on a toilet.
Yes. Anyway, this idea of reventropy, as in reversing entropy, it seems to be that his means of restoring order in the world, specifically, was by making people smaller.
Not working, because all of my nephews and nieces are all massive.
Yeah.
I think we were shorter because we only had biscuits for tea.
People got shorter when we started to farm, didn't we?
Oh, really?
And live in cities, because we were basically healthier and taller when we were hunter-gatherers, and then when we started to, you know, as it civilized, as in city dwell and farm and all that, our population numbers were able to expand, but our basic level of nutrition went down and we became shorter people.
But it's gone up again.
And we've got gradually taller and taller as the nutritional...
As the demand.
Malnutrition is the key. We malnourish a generation, they'll shorten right up.
Maisie, how tall are you?
5'11".
Do you have, like, strict rules about people you go out with or marry or whatever who is taller or shorter than you? Because my tall girlfriends all refuse to go out with somebody who's shorter than me.
I think shorter men can be really, like, attractive, but I would just feel cumbersome, I reckon. My boyfriend is 6 foot.
And was that a deal breaker, as it were? You had to.
I'd love to say no, but it absolutely was.
I like the shallowness of it.
I'm really shallow.
Yeah, no, I'm fine with that.
Very tall, very shallow.
Yeah, I think that's marvelous.
I'm like a candle.
Yeah. There was another Lonely Voice campaigning against something the rest of us take for granted. There's a man called Roger Babson. He was an American stock market guru. He was the guy in the Q series that invented little hammers so that typists could wear mittens and work outside.
He what?
Yeah, he was obsessed with fresh air and he got his secretaries to work outside on typewriters and their hands were too cold, so he invented a series of little hammers so they could wear mittens while typing. Do you think that's crazy? His real passion was that he campaigned against gravity.
Oh, wow.
Mm. So he had a couple of very disturbing events. His sister and then later his grandson died from drowning, and he devoted his considerable fortune to fighting against the evil old man gravity, which he argued killed millions of people every year. And he paid three investigators to sit permanently in the US Patent Office, scanning incoming applications for anti-gravity inventions, anything, costumes, shields, whatever it might be, so that could be used to insulate people from gravity, because he hoped one day to eliminate aeroplane accidents.
There was drownings in his family, and he blamed gravity not water.
No. No, he didn't have an anti-water thing.
Yeah.
In fact, he set up
it's
the gravity...
gravity that pulls you under, isn't it?
Yeah.
I'm not sure that the water's trying to help them.
If there was no gravity, you'd float. And also the water would be
if there was no gravity, the water would be in the air.
Yeah.
So he started something called the Gravity Research Foundation, and the idea was to give out grants to universities. But it had to be used specifically for anti-gravity research. And lots of people didn't know how to do this, so the money didn't get used. Tufts University used it to set up their Institute of Cosmology. And what they do is they acknowledge this grant from the Gravity Research Foundation every year in a ceremony in which the doctorate graduates have an apple dropped on their head in front of a monument to Babson. I mean, he wasn't completely crazy. He was, in a way, he was also a good guy. He set up the very first women's business school in the United States. But I like these campaigns that you just think, wow, is that a thing? There was a campaign in the United States called SINA, S-I-N-A, and it was the Society for Indecency to Naked Animals. It was founded in 1959 with the slogan, "A nude horse is a rude horse," and it campaigned for clothing of
all
any animal. Any animal that stands higher than 4 inches or is longer than 6 inches. There were campaigns right across the United States.
So the tiny little needy animals.
Yeah.
You can have a nude hamster. But not
Dachshund should be dressed just.
It went on for 4 years, this campaign, and then Time magazine found out it was a hoax perpetrated by a comedian called Alan Abel. But I quite like, think I'd have joined in, I think.
It's true that the penises of horses and dogs are very prominent in society. You see them more than you see the penises of humans.
That is true.
In general life, you walk around, you don't see many penises.
No, and I'm fine with that.
If you see one, it's likely to be a dog's penis.
Yeah, that's
right. Or it could be a horse's penis. There'll be so many more horses in the Edwardian era.
Yeah.
The penises would go past, like, scooters
on
Oxford Street. You imagine it, 1910, penis, 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 penis. And this is the Victorian age, not long ended, which was very, very anti-penis, as we know. And yet, all these horses' penises, all the time, everywhere.
Well,
it's logical. Let's get some pants on those horses.
Just pants, not clothes.
I think just pants.
Start with the pants.
Jeez, string.
If you ignore a penis, it will go away.
That's certainly been my experience. Now, short people are just better. Fact. Why can't a robot work out how to tick a box marked "I'm not a robot"?
That's a very good question. Also, why can't it tell what a traffic light looks like?
I don't know. I'm not a robot. I don't think I'm a robot. But I find friendly text messages stressful.
Yeah.
I've got a lot of the signs of a robot.
So it doesn't make any sense. The elves quote a letters page of Viz. Surely robots can figure out how to tick a box on a website saying, "I am not a robot. I've seen Terminator 2, and that one could fly a fucking helicopter." So ticking the box is not the point. It's how you behaved before you ticked the box that is analysed. So, to be honest, I can't tell you all the details because they keep it secret because they don't want people trying to cheat the test. But broadly speaking, you tick the box and it prompts the website to check your browsing history. So let us say, for example, just before you ticked the box, you watched a couple of cat videos, you, I don't know, liked a tweet about Greta Thunberg, you checked your Gmail account before you got down to work. All of that makes them think that you must be a human, and checking the box can even spur it to analyse the way in which you moved your mouse across the screen.
No.
It's slightly spooky, I think. Mm. Essentially, when you are clicking "I am not a robot," you are instructing the site to have a look at your data and decide for itself.
Wow.
If the machine is not sure, that's when it directs you to click on, I don't know, pictures of fire hydrants, aren't there, and sort of secondary check.
So if that comes up, it means that your browsing history...
It's slightly worrying.
It looks like you're a robot.
You're in a Russian warehouse.
Yeah.
If you regularly clear your browsing history or you browse in incognito mode, then it will...
Why would you do that?
That is not the sign of a robot. That's the sign of a wanker.
Yeah. But it's a bit weird, isn't it? It's an automated humanity check. It's called CAPTCHA. CAPTCHA, and it stands for Completely Automated Public Turing Tests to Tell Computers and Humans Apart. But you can do some good with it. You know those distorted letters that you sometimes have to say, what is that word? it's quite a good way to digitise old books. OK, so if you've got an old or torn piece of paper from an old book and you're not entirely sure what the word is, sometimes with Capture they'll give you two words to solve. You get one after the other. One test is to establish whether you're human, and the other word, they're just looking for your opinion.
Ah.
So if 1,000 people say that the word is catacomb, then the chances are it is catacomb. So it's a way of analysing text.
They can't fold towels very easily, though, can they?
No, that is the major flaw in robots.
Yeah.
Now, for a ridiculous loser, what can we say about Mr. Irrelevant 1991? It's a sought-after title in some ways.
Mr. Irrelevant.
Mr. Irrelevant.
Is there some sort of, like, a paradox? It's like being the, you know, the most boring person. Well, that's something interesting if you're the most boring person. So the second most boring person is more boring than the most boring person, which makes them the most boring person, which is something interesting about them. Which makes
I love that. I think that's fantastic. All I can say with confidence is that he was Wanky, which is his name, Mr. Wanky.
Mr. Wanky?
Yeah, Mr. Wanky.
Well, that's so relevant.
Yeah, so every year in US football, professional teams choose new players from that year's college leavers, so it's called the draft. And the last placed team from the previous year gets the first choice. The idea is to even out the team's prospects. And that, so it's not like you can just buy the top players. They try and keep it kind of
level. The opposite of the Premier League. Really.
Yeah. So the player chosen last from the pool, so the least sought after player in that year, is called Mr. Irrelevant. And it's a rather dubious honour. It fell to Larry Wanky. In 1991.
I was really hoping he had a better first name, but yeah,
Larry
Wanky
is not good, is it?
What would a better first name be?
Willie.
Barry.
Willie is better.
Willie Wanky.
But they get a prize. They get flown out for a relevant week with their family to California, and they have, you know...
Introducing the Wankies! Let's have a warm round of applause for the Wankies as they join us.
But it's a thing in sport. The last place competitor in the Tour de France, for example, since 1920, been awarded the Lanterne Rouge. But there's so much publicity with being that person that people want to be it. When they know they're not going to win, and they know they're right at the back, they sometimes hide in barns and things.
I've watched the London Marathon, there's so much attention on who wins it, but I am interested often as to who is the last person.
Like 5 days later.
Yeah.
And a man in an iron lung rolls over the finish line.
There's loads of wonderful things that you get a salted anchovy if you're the loser of the Siena Palio horse race. And it used to be that you got a wooden spoon at Cambridge if you got the worst honours degree in the maths, Tripos.
No!
This is the last one ever awarded to the magnificently named Cuthbert Lemprier Holthouse.
He then went on to become Prime Minister.
He became an Anglican vicar, which is like being in the Church of England.
And so what he... And so what, he got the worst score on his degree?
He got the worst degree. In fact, they made the spoon out of a rowing oar because he blamed it on the fact that he spent so much time rowing.
It's amazing that they actually gave degrees to borrowers.
Well, also, nobody is going to ask a question about who came first in the maths tripos, right? It's just so lovely. I think it's much more interesting to talk about Cuthbert.
Yeah.
And now for the bit where our panel accidentally fall into a lens grinder and make spectacles of themselves. General ignorance, fingers on buzzers, please. Watch this. Have a look at the screen. That text has got the entire answer to the question. Can anybody pick out any of it? Okay, it's going at 1,500 words per minute. What do you call someone who is able to read at that speed?
Fast.
My mother-in-law.
Fast is good, yes. Is your mother-in-law very fast?
She goes on holiday. She literally can read a book a day.
Can she understand it?
Yeah, she's incredible. It's insane how good she is at it.
Yeah, I mean, you can, in principle, train yourself to read pretty quickly. But speed reading, that they used to talk about, it was a thing that people thought you could be taught. In fact, there was an American proponent, Evelyn Wood. She was an educator from Utah. And she made a fortune at these reading dynamic workshops. She said you could increase the speed of reading 3 times, maybe as much as 10 times. And she had hundreds of outlets across the United States, the 1950s and 60s. And it was partly because JFK had a reputation for being able to read 1,200 words per minute. Nixon and Carter, both presidents, both endorsed
1,200 words a minute?
Well, there are various techniques.
It's like 4 pages of a novel.
It's slightly mad. One of the techniques is reading down the middle of the page rather than...
Yeah.
I mean, that makes you wonder as a writer why you bothered with the words at the side. The other thing is to eliminate sub-vocalisations in your head. Reading aloud will slow you down.
I think I'm quite a slow reader because I worry I've missed a bit.
Yeah.
And I'm forever going back and doing a paragraph again. And
but thinking. You're worrying about the comprehension, and that is the thing about speed reading, is that probably people are reading quite quickly, but they're not really fully taking in all the detail. But the technique now of speed reading has been pretty much debunked. It is not a thing.
What did it say, that fast-moving thing?
Everything I just told you.
Oh. Oh. So your whole... all of that was just...
Yeah, wow. Everything I've just told you. But basically, people get to the gist but not the nuance if they're speed reading.
So they sort of go, well, there's something about tigers in that paragraph.
Yeah. Yeah.
This one's all about cheese.
Exactly, I've got it. Tigers and cheese, I've got
it. I love that book.
Yeah. I'm afraid speed readers are missing the point. Who made the most expensive and best-sounding violins ever?
Stradivarius.
That's my boy. Took one for the team.
Yeah, what a guy.
Marks and Spencer.
Yamaha.
Sports Direct.
It was a guy called Bartolomeo Guarnieri. He was the grandson of one of Stradivarius' apprentices. So Stradivarius did make beautiful violins. But this guy has the edge. In 2010, one of his went for more than $18 million. This $18 million violin is on loan to a brilliant woman called Anne Akiko Meyers. I think we have a little tiny bit of her playing.
That sounds like a normal violin to me.
So that is the thing about it, because they did a test to see whether people wanted to buy one of those very expensive ones or whether they wanted a modern one. They got 21 professional violinists to play in a dimly lit room wearing goggles, and only 38%, so 8 out of the 21, chose to take the old ones, and the rest chose the modern instruments. So not necessarily... actually, does it sound any better?
That's like those taste tests when people think they're drinking some incredibly expensive wine, but it's just from Aldi.
Yeah. Yeah. In 2016, a violin made from Winston Churchill's cigar box was sold for
£6,500.
No. Didn't have any strings, but probably smelled nice. And finally, a ludicrously easy one. What the Dickens was the first name of the famous English writer who gave us the expression... what the Dickens? Yes!
William.
Yes! You're absolutely correct. William...
Shakespeare.
William Shakespeare, indeed. Do you know what play?
Is it Merry Wives of Windsor?
It is indeed Merry Wives of Windsor.
How did you know that? He is William Shakespeare.
Do you like this picture?
that's me from the recently closed show.
So Merry Wives of Windsor, Mrs. Page is referring to Falstaff. She's on the cusp of stuffing him in a laundry basket. Where had you this pretty weathercock, says Ford. Mrs. Page says, I cannot tell what the Dickens his name is. Do you know why, Dickens?
No, I don't.
It's a diminutive of Dick. It's a euphemism for the devil. So what the Dickens just means what the devil. It hurts like the Dickens, what we used to say.
Yeah.
It was an old expression, so it hurts like the devil. There was a sort of tradition in medieval plays that if you spoke the devil's name, then he would appear. So that's where we get the expression, speak of the devil.
Really?
There's just so many fantastic words that Shakespeare invented. Merry Wives actually get the first appearances of hot-blooded, the world's my oyster, that phrase.
That's Shakespearean.
It is Shakespearean, yeah, world's absolutely. So it was not Charles Dickens, people might think, what the Dickens, it was Mr. Shakespeare.
He was the first to come up with Scott lead.
Yes, that is correct. Enough Dickensing about. It's time to reveal this week's scores. In last place, it's a noble thing, with minus 7, it's Maisie! Oh, wow. In third place, with minus 6, it's Alan! In second place, with minus 3, David! I know, with one whole point.
What?
Ridiculous number of points. It's Holly! To laugh in the faces of Maisie, David, Holly and Alan and thank them all for their good humour. And I leave you with these words from Dostoevsky. There is no idea and no fact that could not be vulgarised or shown in a ridiculous light. And that pretty much explains QI's existence. Good night. you've just seen was recorded without an audience because of social distancing rules. Next week, we're back to normal. So see you then. And in the meantime, mind how you go.